Can we all make a little noise for the MVP of the day? This bag of throat lozenges.
Erik Gustafsson is a Leaf?
This is nuts. This channel has existed since 2007 for 16 years. I think this is the wildest day of Leafs transactions ever. I would have had the video up for you sooner, but they've made 3 trades in the last hour. So here's what we're gonna do. The Patrick Kane trade video is up on the SDPN Sports YouTube channel. Just look up SDPN, it'll be right there. This is gonna be my second trade video of the day, talking about the Rasmus Sandin trade. And the third video is gonna be for the Engvall trade, the Shen trade, and whatever's next, because I don't think the Leafs are done. Real quick, think you know which way it's gonna go? I don't, straight up don't. But if I did, I'd head to Sports Interaction. When the puck drops and your GM makes 3 or 4 trades in a day, Sports Interaction has you covered. Pre-game, live betting on all major sports and prop bets. Wanna bet? Head over to sportsinteraction.com/SDPN and download the Sports Interaction app. 19 plus though, please play responsibly. This is the trade. The Toronto Maple Leafs have acquired defenseman Erik Gustafsson and Boston's first round selection in the 2023 NHL draft from the Washington Capitals in exchange for Rasmus Sandin. That is a simply wild deal. One that I half saw coming, but not like this. You know, maybe I celebrated a little too early yesterday because I was talking about the Leafs getting Jake McCabe, Sam Lafferty, and in addition to that, Noel Acciari and Ryan O'Reilly without having to give up a roster player. The closest thing the Leafs came to giving up a roster player was Joey Anderson, who wasn't even on the roster. He was sent down to the Marlies. But if you watch the podcast, you'll know that we were trying to figure out who the Leafs' 6 D-men were and how Rasmus Sandin was going to be a part of that. And if you remember correctly, the math was not mathing. Listen, Leaf fans know what Rasmus Sandin is capable of. He's an extremely gifted young player with a propensity for moving the puck up the ice. He feathers on these beautiful shots that are tippable and reboundable. He can run a power play. I think he could run a team's first power play. He's not going to have to do that in Washington, but we know he can run a team's second power play because we saw him do it in Toronto. He's a great hitter, a great reverse hitter. He's kind of a jerk, but here's the thing. It's 2023, and the 2018 first rounder has yet to truly full-time crack the Leafs' top 6. This season, he's been in the top 6 and playing almost every single night, but when the Leafs got Jake McCabe, that became near impossible to do without an injury. They have Riley and Brody. They have McCabe and Hall. They have Giordano and Liljegren. They also have Connor Timmins, and we didn't know that they'd be going out and getting Erik Gustafsson and Luke Shen. Jordy Benn is a viable option this season. Even Victor Mete was a viable option. The Leafs went, I think, undefeated with Mac Hollowell somehow. It seems like there's been friction building with Sandin and the Leafs over the years, and it's got nothing to do with him being an unpopular teammate. He's actually a very popular teammate. The Leafs have a huge Swedish contingent, and he's a big part of that. Problem was, he played in the Montreal playoff series, and he scored in the Montreal playoff series, and what happened the very next game? He was scratched. Comes back in, it doesn't really work out, and obviously the Leafs get eliminated. Then even last year, he still wasn't an everyday player, and injuries definitely didn't help with that. This year, he's on a team that is completely all the way going for it, and the math just was not in his favor. Ironically, the final nail in the coffin for Sandin in Toronto, I think the groundwork was laid months ago. Washington Capitals fans, this is not a guy who plays the right side. Maybe he will. He's still a young player, but Sheldon Keefe tried to play him at the right side in order to get the mathing for him, and it didn't work out at all. On the left side, he's wonderful. He's absolutely wonderful. But now with Riley, Brody can play there, McCabe can play there, Giordano is not coming out of the lineup, and he signed through next year. Sandin held out for a contract extension with Kyle Dubas, and he notably kind of lost. He initially wanted about $1.4 million for 2 years, and they waited and they waited and they waited, and then he ends up signing that exact deal, which was a mirror deal with Timothy Liljegren. Acquiring Connor Timmins seemed to go in Sandin's favor. They had good chemistry and they played together in the Sioux, but Timmins isn't in the top six right now either. Washington Capitals fans, I'm sure you're watching, you're getting a good player. You're getting a player who's maybe going to be a great player, honestly. Rasmus Sandin has a bright future in this league. I'm sure he's going to be an absolute nuisance thorn in the side of the Toronto Maple Leafs for years to come, but you are going to fall in love with this player who unfortunately fell victim to the math game. Now, what do the Leafs get? Erik Gustafsson, a dude who the Leafs kind of helped resurrect his season. There was a game against the Washington Capitals earlier this season, and Erik Gustafsson hadn't scored in something like 50 or 60 games dating back to last year. Well, what happens? Early in the game, he scores. Oh, would you look at that? Of course he breaks his streak against the Toronto Maple Leafs. Oh, he scored again. Of course he scores again against the guy got a hat trick. Erik Gustafsson got an honest to goodness hat trick against the Toronto Maple Leafs earlier this season. And he was just shot out of a cannon after that. Because this guy who once scored over 60 points when he was with the Chicago Blackhawks fell off a cliff in terms of production. He only had 3 goals with Chicago last year and I believe 18 points. This year, 7 goals, 38 points. To give you an idea of how ridiculous that is, Morgan Rielly leads the Leafs defenders in scoring with 29 points. Erik Gustafsson has 9 more points than any other Leafs defender. He is now the highest scoring Leafs defender this season. He hasn't played a game for them. Where does he fit in this Leafs lineup? Legitimately, no idea. I would assume without Rasmus Sandin, he could be a guy who could head up your second power play unit, but the Leafs already have so many options there, guys who have done it. I don't know if it was a priority for Dubas to go out and get him. And today's D pairings at Leafs practice were Jake McCabe on the right of TJ Brody on the left, then Morgan Rielly with Justin Hall, pause for anger, and Mark Giordano with Timothy Liljegren. Add to that Erik Gustafsson, and we now know Luke Shen, we'll get to that next video. Who the heck goes where? I know you need more defensemen than you need on account of you never know how many you need. For example, the Vancouver Canucks, when they went to the Stanley Cup Final in 2011, used 13 of them, but wow. So like out of the group that I just mentioned, who gets out? And you might say, well, Justin Hall. Okay, well then they replace him with Luke Shen. They're not going to replace him with Erik Gustafsson. That doesn't make any sense. Like, does Mark Giordano, who's the oldest skater in the NHL, take some games off coming up? He probably should. Or here's another option. It's entirely possible the Leafs flip Erik Gustafsson. I have no idea at the time I'm shooting this video, but the second I saw the return, Erik Gustafsson and a first from the Bruins of all teams, I thought the Leafs ain't holding on to either of those things. Definitely not the first. So let's talk about the first. I saw some Leaf fans down on the first round pick because it's going to be a high first. Belongs to the Boston Bruins. Even if the Bruins were to get knocked out in the first round, which I don't think they're going to, it would still be a high pick on account of they're going to win the President's Trophy. That being said, like Sandin was picked 28th. Let's say the Bruins do win the Cup. It's 32nd. All that to say, Dubas is perfectly capable of finding a good player at 28, 32. Matthew Nyes was a second rounder. Nick Robertson was a second rounder. Friesen Mitten was a second rounder. And the more important thing around the question of why, in case you're wondering why, the Leafs were not able, under the cap, to activate Matt Murray from long-term injury reserve without moving some cap off the roster. They had options like losing perfectly good roster players for nothing on waivers, or you can go and trade a player who's probably not going to be in your top six come these playoffs anyway for a first round pick and a perfectly usable NHL player. in Erik Gustafsson. Now, before you look at Gustafsson's stats and the fact that he'd be the highest scoring Leaf defender, and you go, Steve, you're putting Luke Shen with Morgan Rielly. Hey, dummy, he's clearly the best. A lot of fans of teams that have had Gustafsson, the Blackhawks, the Habs, I believe, had him in the Capitals. He's not so good at the whole defense thing. Remember when the Leafs had TJ Brennan and we would look at his numbers in the AHL and we would go, why isn't this guy playing with the Leafs? And then he would play with the Leafs and you go, oh, that's why. Erik Gustafsson is a better version of that. But do the Leafs have so many offensive weapons now that they can get away with it? It's like I often say on the podcast, like, instead of putting band-aid solutions on weaknesses, why not strengthen your strengths? The Leafs score goals. They've struggled with it in the playoffs. Well, getting Erik Gustafsson would actually help you score goals in the playoffs. But you know what else would help you score? Trading the first round pick that you got from the Bruins from Washington. But who do you trade it for? Can you afford them under the cap? This is blowing my mind! Washington Capitals fans, please take care of Rasmus Sandin. He's a Sioux Greyhound. Kyle Dubas does love his guys. This is him doing right by one of his guys. He was a good Leaf. He was probably going to be a great Leaf for a long time. The math wasn't mathing, and he found him a home. That dude is going to get to play with Alexander Ovechkin. There's worse ways to be as a professional hockey player. Good for him. This is from Ian Oland of Russian Machine Never Breaks, a Washington Capitals blog that I love very much. All I can say about Erik Gustafsson is that he's the type of guy who can win you a playoff series by himself. Oh, I love that. Or lose you a playoff series by himself. Oh, okay. First 2 months of the season, he hemorrhaged high danger chances at 5-on-5 against. Had a great December. Bad defensive instincts. Oh, well, I don't like that very much. Like, if you were to imagine a gunslinging defenseman that fills you with anxiety, he's your guy. Oh, Ian, you're really selling me on this. If he can play calm and tone down his pinching and aggressiveness, he did in January and February, he can be pretty effective. Really good indirect passer. Not a great shot. And Leafs fans, what do I think of the Engvall deal? What do I think of the Shen deal? What do I think of the trade that has or hasn't happened yet? Oh, my phone. It's eerily calm after setting on fire for like 2 hours. Anyway, that'll be the next video. For now, that is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. I'm gonna have like a drink of water and then shoot the next one.